Hey YouTube, welcome back. And in today's video, we're going to be going over major depressive disorder and how it's going to appear on the exam. So stay tuned. Okay, so as we see here, according to the DSM-5, an individual must be experiencing five or more symptoms during the same 2-week period, and at least one of the symptoms should be either A, depressed mood, or B, anhedonia, which is a loss of interest or pleasure. Now, oh, and as a quick tip I included for you guys, if the medication begins with a P or F, it's a depressive disorder medication. If the medication ends in PRAM, which is P-R-A-M, it's a depressive disorder medication. And as you see here, I've listed the antidepressants or the SSRIs. And if you guys missed this video, definitely check out the link in the description to find the best and quickest way to memorize the medications. It helps when we're studying to include the medications associated with the disorder. So that way, it just that double studying, it really compounds when we're getting our study sessions in. So definitely check the link in the description, check that video out, and let's jump back into the video. So on the exam, they're not going to say, a client walks into your office and reports that they're experiencing symptoms, right? We more so want to take it from the paper and put it into practice, right? Think of not just what the symptoms are, but more so what does someone experiencing these symptoms look like in their functioning. It's one thing to read a textbook and say, okay, or in this case, a DSM-5, and say, okay, I understand the criteria, I memorized it, okay. But what does that look like in real life? What does that look like in practice? So the exam wants you to be able to identify what symptoms must be present and how these symptoms can look like in real life. And listed below are some examples of how it may appear on the exam. Because again, the exam's not simply going to say, a client walks into your office and they give you a list of all their symptoms of this. They're more so going to tell you things in their functioning, and for they want you, the therapist, the exam that is, wants you, the therapist, the social worker, to be able to kind of pick up on these things and say, okay, this behavior is a reflection of this symptom, so that we can apply it. And that also goes into the work we do in real life. So symptoms have to be present for at least 2 weeks. The time frame, big giveaway, it has to be present for 2 weeks. Depressed mood, a client reports that they have been feeling down for over a month and will often isolate within their room. So if the client reports that they've been isolating, kind of bombarding themselves within their room, that's a clear sign that, hey, they've been isolating. And with the mood, that is something they can say, hey, my mood hasn't been the best in X amount of time. For anhedonia, inability to feel pleasure in previously enjoyed activities, the client could report they have not played their guitar in over a month, or insert important task or a hobby that they really enjoyed, but as of late, they haven't been getting much enjoyment, fulfillment out of it. That's how the test wants us to be able to kind of identify, oh, it looks like this person is experiencing anhedonia. Changes in their biological functioning of sleep and appetite. So whenever we have those type of changes for sleep, the quality is impacted. So it either increases, so we're oversleeping, or we're not sleeping enough because it's hard getting to sleep. And a change in appetite, and our appetite can either go up or it can either go down, and it can look something like client reports sleeping throughout the day, or the client reports eating one meal a day as of late. It could also be phrased as the client reports not having much of an appetite, right? Again, on paper versus in real life, they're functioning. The exam wants you, the social worker, to be able to identify the behaviors that's representing these symptoms. Feelings of worthlessness and helplessness and hopelessness. So the client reports feeling like a burden to their friends or family, feeling like, you know, that's their life, you know, don't worry about me type of thing. Again, if they're experiencing the worthlessness and just not feeling great about themselves and how it's impacting the people around them. Decreased concentration and focus. It could appear on the exam as client reports, difficulty focusing at work or school, or again, you can insert an important task here. And on the exam, the question could speak to that of the client had to take a leave of absence from work because they had difficulty focusing or concentrating on the task at hand. Fatigue / low energy. The client reports that they have not done their laundry or washed dishes in the past month due to feeling too tired and lacking energy. Again, things that are impacting their overall functioning, their ADLs, which is activities of daily living, they're going down, like, you know, basic chores, just tasks that are pretty common. Because they're experiencing this depression, it's all being impacted. And possible suicidal ideation. It's not a guarantee that a client who is depressed will be experiencing suicidal ideation, but if it does appear on the exam, it could look like client states, I wish I could go to sleep and not wake up. Now, of course, that's a red flag. So we want to be able to address that, of course. We want to make sure that we address it or that the question addresses it in a proper manner before moving on. But if it has been addressed and it's not a safety concern or anything like that, this is, again, how it may appear on the exam. And as we go to how to differentiate, so this is a big key right here, because on the exam, the exam's not just going to give us the full criteria of things, right? The exam wants us to be able to say, is it this or is it that? Is it that or is it this? And there's going to be some key differences that's going to be able to give us our answer and identifying what it is and what it's not, based off of the time frame and just how it's being displayed in the client's functioning. So let's look at unspecified depressive disorder. Does not fully meet the criteria of MDD. On the exam, if you narrowed the answer choices down to MDD and unspecified depressive disorder, go with unspecified depressive disorder if the main criteria we need to be present for MDD is not present within the question. So symptoms present for 2 weeks, depressed mood and or anhedonia, changes in sleep and or appetite, and a person with less severe symptoms of depression. So remember earlier, just to scroll back up, when we were talking about MDD, one of two things need to be present at least for 2 weeks. A, a depressed mood, or B, anhedonia. If we don't see those things in the way that they need to be present, let's go with unspecified. But usually on the exam, in my experience and other people's experience from what I've heard, it's usually MDD. Now let's look at bereavement. Grieving the loss / death of a loved one has to be present. So when we're dealing with bereavement, granted, that can look like depression, right? Because someone just lost, a client just lost someone, right? But if we don't see something of a loss or a death, we might want to kind of shift away from that, because that's a key component for bereavement. Could have feelings of loss, self-blame, but you are looking for someone that's responding to the death of someone or, again, a loss. If that's not present, we might want to focus more so back to another answer choice like MDD possibly. And when we look at persistent depressive disorder, symptoms are milder than that of MDD. Depressed mood for at least 2 years in adults, that's a big giveaway. So if the exam doesn't say anything about a time frame, or if it said, oh, for a month or whatever the case may be, it hasn't been 2 years. The time frames are very important. Pay attention to the time frames. They're not always going to specifically say, hey, it's been 2 weeks or it's been 2 years. Sometimes it could say, the client reports feeling this way for the past 3 years. So I was like, oh, 3 years. That's when our antennas kind of go up a bit. And it's like, okay, so it could be persistent depressive disorder if that's what the question is asking. And that's one of the answer choices. And we see that time frame. Oh, it's like, oh, it could be that, right? At least 1 year in children. Someone who is chronically mildly depressed. So that kind of speaks to the ongoing bit of it. And changes in their biological functioning of sleep and appetite are not common. This is another big giveaway. So if you see changes to the quality of someone's sleep and appetite, it's more so shifting towards MDD, but it's not really common. Not saying it can't appear, but it's not super common in persistent depressive disorder. And lastly, maybe feeling down or depressed with their mood because it's ongoing. It's a chronic situation they're dealing with. Adjustment disorder with depressed mood. So a recent life stressor, so getting a new job, moving, changes in relationship statuses, etc. Symptoms have to become present within 3 months of the stressor, but cannot go beyond 6 months. So if we're reading through the question, we want to be able to identify something recent, again, change in a job, relocating, change in relationship status, right? And the symptoms have to be present for 3 months of the stressor, but cannot go beyond 6 months. Once it goes beyond 6 months, we take adjustment disorder with depressed mood and we move it to the side because that's not exactly fitting what the question is asking. If it wants us to say, hey, what is this based off of the information provided? Because if it went beyond that 6 month period, adjustment disorder with depressed mood, it's out. Here's the anxiety relief reminder. The exam can be tricky, but it's not trying to nitpick down to the smallest detail to the point where the answer can either be this or that. I have never had or heard of someone having an answer choice of MDD, UDD, PDD, and ADDM within the same answer pool for a question. So keep that in mind. The exam gives you enough information within the question to be able to differentiate between the disorders. So again, just to kind of reflect back up again, pay attention to the time frames they give us because that's going to be a big, big giveaway. And when we go back up to MDD, again, we need to see a depressed mood for a period of time or anhedonia. We could see both, right? And at least a 2 week period. If they say, hey, this person's been feeling like this for the past 4 days, we can't do MDD. Why? It hasn't been those 14 days. It hasn't been that 2 weeks. So again, going all the way back down to the anxiety reminder. The exam can be tricky, but it's not trying to nitpick to the point where it's up. It listed everything that's applicable to all the mood-related disorders, but that one single thing is not trying to nitpick to that degree, but we do need to know the time frames and the criteria that absolutely need to be present. Because if we know those two things, we're good to go. We're golden. So that's all I have for today. Thank you guys. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe as I plan to come out with more videos. See you soon. Bye.